Hello. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. My name is Aiden. I'm a master's student with the Social Justice Institute. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we are gathered here today on traditional, ancestral, and the unceded and occupied territory of the Musqueam people. And the Social Justice Institute, we like to take this seriously and not just saying it, just to be saying it, and realizing that we are on stolen land. Before I go on to introduce our great speaker, I would like to just make a plug for our lecture series. If you haven't already, take a look at our other events that we'll be putting on this term. Each one will be Wednesday, 12 to 1, with lunch provided with an RSVP. We have a Facebook events page, Social Justice Institute BBC, as well as a Twitter, at GRSJ Institute. So please use the hashtags, hashtag GRSJ, or hashtag GRSJ events. So today we are so excited to partner up with Teacher Education for All project at UBC's Teacher Education, as well as the Critical Racial and Anti-Colonial Studies Research Network, to have Dr. Roderick Ferguson to speak on the contents of Rotimi's Trunk, a chapter in the Bookshop of Black Queer Diaspora. Roderick Ferguson is professor in African American and Gender and Women's Studies at the University of Illinois, Chicago. He is the author of Aberrations in Black, Toward a Queer, a Color Critique, and The Reorder of Things, the University and Its Pedagogies of Minority Difference, and co-editor of Strange Affinities, The Gender and Sexual Politics of Comparative Racialization. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Roderick Ferguson.
All right, can everybody hear me in the back? Yeah? Okay. Okay, my thanks to Jen Song for this invitation. It's my pleasure to be here. Let me begin by explaining the context out of which this talk comes, which will help clarify the form that the talk takes. Right? It's part of a new book project entitled The Bookshop of Black Queer Diaspora. In terms of subject matter, the book looks at black queer art and activism in North America and the UK to assess the rise of neoliberal formations in those regions and the challenges to those formations. But the story is told through a series of visits to an imaginary, an underlying imaginary, black queer bookshop. One that contains various artifacts, books, paintings, maps, albums, sculptures, masks, tapestries, posters, and a trunk. The trunk that belonged to the British Nigerian queer artist, Rotimi Fani-Kayode, 1955 to 1989, Fani-Kayode's photographs are well known for how they overlay Yoruba and Christian iconographies with homoerotic depictions of black men. Archived at Autograph ABP, the Black Photography and Film Center in East London, the photographs were actually part of the contents of a trunk that Fani-Kayode's partner, Alex Hurst, donated to Autograph after Fani-Kayode's death. In this talk, I explore the trunk as a symbol of black migration to the UK and how the movement of black diasporic populations to the British metropole became the site for observing the workings of sexuality, race, empire, and diaspora. The talk also addresses the trunk and its contents as entities that defy any singular national belonging, a fact that makes the trunk meaningful for any discussion of the black queer diasporic communities that were emerging in the UK and the US during the 1980s. Meaningful as an account of a black subject's displacement from home. I should also add, not just the UK, the US, but also Canada, and I can say where that impetus comes from in the Q&A. Significant as evidence of art's capacity to reconcile marginalized subjects with the fact of racial displacement, and important as the final effects of a queer subject who became one of the many casualties of the HIV/AIDS epidemic. In this way, the trunk is the evidence of an attempt to determine the requirements of Black queer diasporic life as it was being invented, as it was recomposed through rearticulations of Yoruba cosmologies and the histories of colonialism, turning the trunk into an artifact that might tell us how to meet those requirements and make our homes, even in the context of social death and the catastrophes of neoliberalism. I also just realized 2 days ago that this series is about the neoliberal university, so I apologize for not addressing that. I will be happy to address it and connect it to that topic in the Q&A, okay? And to the work that I've done on it. The trunk sits up against a wall in the eastern part of the bookshop. The lid is open. The inside of the lid has been painted black, giving the impression that the trunk is old beyond its years, producing a contrast between an aged patina with wood that is still creamy and white. Inside the trunk are a series of black and white photographs depicting mostly black, young black men. There are 2 pictures of a model with his arms crossed, looking directly at the camera. You are told that he was one of Fani-Kayode's favorite models and that his name was Razor. There's another photo of a young black man whose head is leaning on the arm of another black man. On the other end of the box is a photo of a black male with albinism, his chest, neck, shoulders, and part of his face filling much of the photograph's space. The photos mark the trunk as the evidence of Fani-Kayode's interest in the black male form, both as an artist and as a queer man. Discussing his interest, he said in 1988, quote, "It has been my destiny to end up as an artist with a sexual taste for other young men. As a result of this, a certain distance has necessarily developed between myself and my origins. The distance is even greater as a result of my having left Africa as a refugee over 20 years ago." End quote. Fani-Kayode was born in Nigeria to a prominent Yoruba family. At the age of 12, he and his family fled to Britain because of the outbreak of the Nigerian Civil War, a war that was, to a degree, the result of the Igbos in the southeastern region of the country, voting in 1967 to declare an independent Igbo state called the Republic of Biafra. Ideologically, the secession of the southeastern territory and the establishment of Biafra were motivated by the discourse of national self-determination. The proclamation of Biafra in 1967 stated, for example, quote, "The desire on the part of the minority groups for self-determination is the active force behind the demand for the creation of more states," end quote. The proclamation went on to locate Biafran independence in the, quote, "heroic struggles of all peoples all over the world for their national freedom," end quote. The Nigerian state's response would be protracted and brutal. For 2.5 years, Nigeria's federal military government would wage a war backed by the British and the Soviet Union on the breakaway republic. The opposing forces would produce a blockade that would result in the deaths of over 1 million people through fighting and planned starvation. For many, this would be the end of the post-colonial dream. Sitting there in the bookshop, the trunk bears witness to that distance between Fani-Kayode's history as a young refugee and his life as a developing black queer artist in the UK. You think to yourself how the trunk carries the symbolic and discursive weight associated with suitcases. Discussing that weight, the visual culture scholar Irit Rogoff writes, quote, "The suitcase signifies the moment of rupture, the instance in which the subject is torn out of a web of connectedness that contained him or her through an invisible net of belonging," end quote. Read as a sign of the ruptures produced by the Nigerian Civil War, the trunk expresses the violence of war and migration. The aged look of the trunk acknowledges a history that is distant, traumatic, and inscribed on bodies still in their prime. It is a look that imprints black queer communities with post-colonial failures. There is a rumor that Fani-Kayode and Hearst used the trunk as a coffee table. In this way, the trunk represents an attempt to create a queer life from scratch, perhaps without the benefits of African models who could show Fani-Kayode how to combine elements that were no doubt presented as irreconcilable, how blackness might consort with homosexuality and yield non-normative forms of personhood and collectivity. The imagined community of black queer diaspora in the 70s and 80s emerged when certain cultural presumptions lost their axiomatic grip. The first of these was the idea that the nation-state form could provide sufficient accommodations for the heterogeneous groups within a society. The Nigerian Civil War, for many, put that notion to rest. The second was that national liberation would automatically produce political and ideological alternatives to bourgeois and Western state nationalism. As Cornel West argued in The New Cultural Politics of Difference, quote, "One crucial lesson of the decolonization process remains the manner in which most third world authoritarian bureaucratic elites deploy essentialist rhetorics about homogeneous national communities and positive images in order to repress and regiment their diverse and heterogeneous populations," end quote. The third was that heteropatriarchy is the natural and indigenous order for any functioning non-Western society. M. Jackie Alexander, Gayatri Gopinath, Chandra Mohanty, and others have written about the ways in which heteropatriarchy was naturalized through colonial laws and then sustained through post-colonial legislative maneuvers. As a coffee table, born out of exile, the trunk would have stood for an emphatic and informed no to the presumption that emerging black queer subjects and communities would simply yield to straitjacketed rhetorics about homogeneous national communities and positive images. In her essay, Rotimi Fani-Kayode, A Counterfigure, the curator Renee Musai touches on how Fani-Kayode's artwork challenged those prescriptions. She writes, quote, "Among his contemporaries, Rotimi Fani-Kayode was without precedent. The repertoire of signifiers and tropes deployed in his photographic tableau was so shockingly other. Black, African, punk, bohemian, queer, and taboo all at once. Cryptic and canonical in equal measures, no one in the field of visual arts practice in Britain was deconstructing African iconography and injecting homoerotic desire with such passion and vehemence as he did. This was uncharted territory," end quote. This photograph, called Under the Surplice, hangs in the same room as the trunk. It depicts a young Yoruba priest whose naked lover kneels next to him and enters him through his robes. Here is the tableau to which Masai refers, the African iconography signified through the robe and the injection of homoerotic desire in the image of the fellating lover and the supplicating priest. The photo was made in 1987, and about that decade, Musai argues, quote, "This was a time in which the black body as a site of inscription was only just entering the frame of self-representation. To imagine it nude and in autoerotic ecstasy was a radical gesture," end quote. Above the trunk hangs an African mask. The shop owners must have placed it there as a reference to Fani-Kayode's art. About the mask, Fani-Kayode wrote, quote, "In African traditional art, the mask does not represent a material reality. Rather, the artist strives to approach a spiritual reality in it through the images suggested by human and animal forms. I think photography can aspire to the same imaginative interpretations of life," end quote. You look again at the photos in the trunk and realize that for one set of eyes, the photos of the black male bodies would simply be the evidence of homoerotic titillation. But for Fani-Kayode, they were in fact the aspiration toward a spiritual reality that was also tied to the production of a diasporic blackness and homoeroticism, a way of saying that the ancestor, the tie between then and now, and queer sexuality, the ground to imagine homoerotic relationships, were one and the same. You consider how this kind of imagination, one in which photography would be the sacred territory for calling on the homoerotic and the ancestral, would be crucial for a period in which neoliberalism was attacking all forms of social solidarity, as David Harvey has put it. With his photography, Fani-Kayode was aiming to create forms of fraternity that would include not only the living, but also the dead, alliances that could challenge neoliberalism's efforts at decimation. As a student of art, you begin to realize that Fani-Kayode's work runs against the grain of our critical assumptions about the history of photography itself. For instance, in his classic piece, The Work of Art in the Age of Its Technological Reproducibility, Walter Benjamin said that the technological reproduction of art through graphic art, lithography, film, audio recordings, and photography bears an antagonistic relationship to tradition. As he put it, quote, it might be stated as a general formula that the technology of reproduction detaches the reproduced object from the sphere of tradition. By replicating the work many times over, it substitutes a mass existence for a unique existence, end quote. Fani-Kayode's photography seems to represent an effort to overturn that presumption. In his photography, technological reproduction would become the basis of attaching photography to the sphere of tradition and history. And in a 1988 article written for the British photography magazine, 10-8, he produced a theory of photographic reproduction as a way to extend and rearticulate African cosmologies. He wrote, quote, in African traditional art, the mass does not represent a material reality. Rather, the artist strives to approach a spiritual reality in it through images suggested by human and animal forms. I think photography can aspire to the same imaginative interpretations of life. My reality is not the same as that which is often presented to us in Western photographs. As an African working in a Western medium, I try to bring out the spiritual dimension in my pictures so that concepts of reality become ambiguous and are open to reinterpretation. This requires what Yoruba priests and artists call a technique of ecstasy. For him, photography can aspire to the techniques of the African mask and move toward those aspects that lie beneath, behind, and alongside the visible plateaus of reality. As such, photography is then stretched beyond those Western functions that would consign it to recording the empirically given. For Fani-Kayode, an African subject is placed in the West, himself a metonym for emergent black and queer color communities. Photography would not simply be a way of alienating tradition via mass distribution, but could become a means of disseminating and evolving tradition through mass distribution. There, in the bookshop's curiosities, you mull over the possibility that perhaps the first instance, at least in the history of black diaspora, in which the displaced use mass distribution as a technology for spreading ancient help was the slave trade itself. In his classic book, Myth, Literature, and the African World, the Yoruba Nigerian writer Wole Soyinka connected the displacement of the slave trade to the transmission of Yoruba cosmologies, writing, quote, a determination to replant the displaced racial psyche was one reason for the ease and permanence with which the African gods were syncretized with Roman Catholic saints. The process was so complete that these deities became part of the spiritual lives of the white Roman Catholics themselves, who in Brazil or Cuba became regular worshippers in the candomblé or bembe, the respective Brazilian and Cuban terms, adopting the Yoruba Orisha in their full essence as their patron gods, end quote. In this instance, the masses would not simply be the victims of the looming and terrifying social processes of the slave trade, but would become technicians who would turn its extensive and dehumanizing structures into circuits of cultural production. Even more, we can locate Fani-Kayode's theory of photography within the Black radical tradition's understanding of culture. Discussing that role, Cedric Robinson argued in Black Marxism, quote, Marx had not realized fully that the cargoes of laborers also contained African cultures, critical mixes and admixtures of language and thought, of cosmology and metaphysics, of habits, beliefs, and morality. These were the actual terms of their humanity. These cargoes, then, did not consist of intellectual isolates or deculturated blacks, men, women, and children separated from their previous universe. African labor brought the past with it, a past that had produced it and settled on it the first elements of consciousness and comprehension, end quote. For Robinson, what the cargo brought with them in the way of culture represented a rebuttal to Marx's presumptions of abstract labor. Culture marked African labor, presenting it as anything but the blank tablet of historical processes. As a cultural form, in Robinson's sense, photography for Fani-Kayode would be a method of showing that history and insights are etched onto life. And like the photographs sitting in the trunk, those histories of trauma and pleasure and the insights derived from them are part of what we carry with us along our perilous journeys. You look at the trunk's patina once again and ruminate on the fact that trunks are not only part of the history of migration, but commerce as well. How they were staples of the 17th century world, a world that the 18th century British philosopher, economist, and historian David Hume described as, quote, a universal fermentation in which navigation had extended itself over the whole globe, end quote. Examining how Hume was steeped in the 18th century commercial scene of the Atlantic, historian Emma Rothschild argues, quote, Hume was thought of in his lifetime and for much of the 19th century as the first great theorist of long-distance commerce, or of what one of his biographers described in 1846 as the social economy of the globe, end quote. An 18th century economy denoted by the global commerce in goods, land, and people. Indeed, as the political theorist Onur Ulas Inse argues, colonial plantation slavery presented Hume with the stinging conundrum, creating as it did, quote, a powerful engine of global commerce and an uncivil institution that contravened the conventions of modern European civility, end quote. Because of this conundrum, that was in fact a founding contradiction, the same processes that had produced modern Western notions of civility would also engender the conditions for exploitation and inhumanity. As Inse explains, quote, imperial frontiers comprised a great testing ground for the operation of commerce outside the restrictive institutions, customs, and norms regnant in Britain, wherein economic entrepreneurs found unprecedented freedom in devising novel and violent forms of extraction and exploitation, end quote. This arrangement between modern civility and modern deviation would make its way to late 19th century British colonialism as well. In fact, you can see it specifically in the 1886 Royal Charter granted to the National African Company, later called the Royal Niger Company. The charter that began the colonial seizure of Nigeria and other lands. Straining to present colonialism as a civilizing and respectful venture, the charter states, quote, in the administration of justice by the company to the peoples of its territories, or to any of the inhabitants thereof, careful regard shall always be had to the customs and laws of the class, or tribe, or nation to which the parties respectively belong, especially with respect to the holding, possession, transfer, and disposition of lands and goods, and testate or intestate succession thereto, and marriage, divorce, and legitimacy, and other rights of property and personal rights," end quote. The civilized tone of the charter notwithstanding, the colonial record in Nigeria is replete with abuses. From the start of the charter in 1886 to 1890, the Royal Niger Constabulary conducted over 100 military expeditions in the southern parts of Nigeria, forcing leaders there to pin their names to treaties. And seizing control of oil in 1891, the British established the Oil Coast Protectorate, which would later be renamed the Niger Coast Protectorate. In the room where the trunk lies, there's a curious self-portrait of a naked Fani-Kayode, holding a white parasol, striking a pose that is very much reminiscent of the colonial lady. On further inquiry, you are told two things: that the photo came with the trunk, and that one of Fanny Coyote's favorite films was the American Disney musical, Mary Poppins. It's been some years since you've seen the movie, but you recall it depicts a moment in the Victorian era, a moment in which patriarchal authority is challenged by social transformations on the horizon. Transformations symbolized literally by the magical and iconoclastic nanny who, using her umbrella, glides in on the winds of change. You learn also that, as an accessory, the umbrella's associations with feminine civility characterize only part of its history. It was also linked to iconoclasm. In point of fact, the Italian futurist Mine del Cite designed a parasol and said this, quote, "An accessory for sporty women, it exalts the speed and beauty of airplanes, the motor car, and the motorboat in an exhilarating race," end quote. The parasol in the photo seems to adhere more to this description. As an accessory for a naked, black, queer, immigrant artist, it gestures toward the upsetting of bourgeois discourses and norms, a disruption carried out by Fani Kayode and the diverse communities that he represented as they made a vehicle of the wind. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ferguson. Now we invite questions or observations from the audience.
Moved to the UK? 12, I think it was. I could be wrong, but I think he was 12. And he was from an elite Yoruba family, right? And, you know, still the circumstances, other than, you know, them fleeing the civil war in Biafra, still a bit murky in terms of what exactly about the Biafran War lead to their flight. But, you know, it's interesting because one of the reasons that I'm drawn to that part of his biography is that nobody talks about it. You know, when you have discussions of his art or his life, you know, it's a kind of passing reference, right? But then I thought, well, what would it, you know, mean to try and read, you know, his work as having traces of that flight on it, you know, so that the work isn't, or so that, you know, the depictions of homoeroticism, you know, and black queerness are layered, you know, with the history of, you know, war, you know, and refugee displacement. But also, you know, again, the failures of the post-colonial dream. I mean, there's a line that I like to quote from M. Jackie Alexander's Not Just Anybody Can Be a Citizen, in that article where she begins with, you know, I am now a criminal in the country of my birth. You know, I, like so many people, thought that upon independence, massive day would be done, you know? And so you have in that story, but also in his story, the sort of repetition of all the assumptions around dignity and new personhood that post-colonial independence would bring with it, you know, crumble.
Since you brought up the fact that he's from an elite family, mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could speak on the ways in which you think his class might have impacted his maybe aesthetic or the way he looked at it.
It's a good question. I'm not, let me answer it this way. One of the things that I wanted to talk about, but I just didn't have time to talk about, in this piece, but will in the book, is his training at art school. He went to Pratt Institute, and about a year ago, a year and a half ago, when I was visiting Autograph, the place that archives his work, Renee Musai, the curator there, said to me, well, you know, he did all these paintings, too. And I said, he did paintings. Nobody's ever said anything about him doing paintings. And I said, she just pulled out of a drawer, like, all these paintings from art school. And interestingly enough, he started off as a painter first. And I'm told that, you know, this, well, as a few months ago, Kobina Mercer and I were the only people that seen the paintings. And the paintings are completely absent of blacks. You know, they're all white men and white women. And it's not until 1984 that he moves into photography, and that photography becomes the way to explore black people. And I mention that in terms of class because there's a certain kind of, not just class, but also racial pedagogy, you know, that's being given to him through the paintings. You know, you start with white people, you end with white people. And it's also quite unusual for someone who starts off as a painter to go into photography, you know, into a sort of lesser art. You know, I think in terms of in this photo, you know, you see the class identification, you know, with Mary Poppins, even as there's an overturning of Mary Poppins. It actually reminds me of Jenny Livingston's Paris is Burning, you know, where the participants in the balls, you know, are so into, you know, Marilyn Monroe, and in fact, Dorian Corey says, oh, she's like, all, you know, when I was coming up, all the queens wanted to be Marilyn Monroe or Marlene Dietrich or Joan Crawford. She's like, I want to be Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge. What's interesting about that film and about this photo is that it actually disturbs it presents itself as a sort of, you know, a kind of symmetry with a bourgeois class aesthetic, you know, and then there's the sort of coming at it at an angle, you know, the revision of it so that it's actually not, you know, the bourgeois reproduction that it is assumed to be on first glance. Yeah. So I think that the class elements are there. I think he, in this photo at least, I read it as him deliberately trying to disturb his own class identifications with, as the film does. I mean, you know, it's been a long time since I've seen Mary Poppins. But, I mean, that film is a critique a bourgeois class formation up until the beginning, which is actually, I understand, quite different from the novel, that the novel sustains the critique even up until the end. In the end of the movie, you know, the families reconcile, the patriarch goes back to being a banker, but a kind of gentler banker, you know, and that's not in the novel. Thanks. Hi.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting that you've sort of been speaking about this artist in context of, you know, his early biography and that the questions of travel come up and that photography is a medium of travel. And I was just curious if you could speak sort of maybe a little bit more to how you're sort of like thinking about the medium of photography as this kind of transition point.
Yeah, transition point.
Between like different kinds of mediums, like different, you know.
Yeah, I think I get it. I think, you know, photography for me and in this piece and with him, you know, it's, you know, a lot of histories converge there. You know, there's his own personal biography of moving from painting to photography, but the move from painting to photography is also, you know, a kind of racial project and racial transition, you know, to one at the level of the aesthetic. But then there's also then the history of photography, you know, that you were getting at here, where photography is the bourgeois medium, you know, of the 19th century. So caught up in portraiture, you know, it's caught up in the presentation of, you know, the great man or the ideal family or the proper lady, you know. You know, it is also caught up in the process of industrialization, you know, the whole possibility of mass distribution, you know, it in film, sound recordings, those are the great arts, you know, of the industrial, you know, period. I see him as, you know, trying to not only, you know, recompose homosexuality and recompose what we think of as blackness, but also to recompose what we think of as, you know, these social and aesthetic formations, a history of industrialization, you know, the history of colonialism. There's also a way in which, for me, it you know, your question bears on the whole topic of David Hume, right? Which is why I bring him up in this piece. You know, Hume, in addition to being the first great theorist of global commerce, was also the founder of empiricism. You know, so the idea that the idea of scientific observation, the idea of analytic observation, right? That there is a possibility of deriving truth from how we observe, right? And in this, he not only gave birth to, you know, the sort of scientific method in the natural sciences, but also in the social and humanities, social science and humanities. Anthropology would be nothing without him. Poli-sci would be nothing without him. You know, the science part of poli-sci, you know, anthropology's emphasis on, you know, the empirical observation of the native other. You know, so there's also a way in which his photography, you know, intervenes into that anthropological slash photographic enterprise, you know, as well. So there are a lot of histories that, you know, are overdetermined in his investment in photography. I mean, it, with the Hume, again, you know, it was all about what could be seen. You know, reality exists at the level of the transparent. And in fact, what he's saying is that what he's saying in relation to photography is no, you know, it is not simply beholden to its empirical functions. You know, that it can be a medium for capturing the invisible. You know, right? That's a complete revision of the photographic enterprise. So I, you know, that's a lot of stuff there, but I don't think it's it. Yes.
You mentioned at one point that these images coming when they did in the in like 1985-86, that it's a moment where previously there hadn't been the kind of self-representation of like a black queer sexuality. And I'm wondering about how that sort of interacts with our current moment where, you know, things have sort of changed since then, and what does it mean when those images are sort of recirculated within a different context? And I'm sort of thinking ahead to speaker who's coming in a couple weeks as part of the series, Riley Snorton, and when he talks about like the hyper-visibility of black sexuality. So I wonder if you could just sort of speak
to
that.
Sure, yeah, totally. I mean, I think that, you know, when Rene Masai says that in terms of, you know, he was the first to, you know, really work with at the visual level as an artist, you know, the kind of the tableau, right, of black queer sexuality. I mean, she's really talking about a kind of critical work. I mean, because you could actually find, you know, in, you know, Marlon Riggs, you know, his contemporary and black queer filmmaker, you know, gets at this and talks on Tide that. That being said, there was a sort of hypervisibility in like the horror magazines, you know, of black gay men with like these, you know, huge penises, and you know, there's this one cartoon image of in Tongues Untied where it's a black man whose nipples are, you know, are almost like are dripping cum, you know, and then he says in the dialogue box, "Come on, it's your feeding time." There's a white guy, you know, across from him. So there were, you know, there was this sort of hyper visibility of, in terms of, you know, the sort of pornographic image, but in terms of the kind of visual experiments with you know, the complexity, the historical nature, you know, the aesthetic layers of black queer bodies, that was new. At the same time, one of the things that he points to in his one of his essays or his diary is he says that he has a stinging observation of the art world where he says that he says something like the trade was about the investment and the fetishization of Africans and African culture, and now the art world is doing that, and I'm caught up in it, you know? So he was also aware that part of what was emerging at this moment was the art world's fetishization of difference. And so he wanted to put a kind of, it seems to me from that quote, he wanted to put a kind of distance between himself and what the art world was doing, even as he was, you know, becoming much celebrated, you know, through the art world. You know, so part of what interests me in just the history of black queer art in this moment is, you know, it is the moment in which, one, there's an enormous and exciting experimentation with the possibilities of black representation in general, black feminism, black queer representations in particular. And at the same time, a in corporate and media investment, art world investment, too, in the circulation of black imagery. And how is what the artists were trying to do with pieces like this different from what that sort of dominant circulation could account for? Yeah. So in many ways, I mean, I said I forgot that this was a neoliberal university speaker series. You know, part of the reason that I'm interested in this is because, you know, in the last book, well, the second book ever. I have another book coming out, so I was going to say the last book, but that's not the last book. And the reorder things about the sort of hegemonic affirmation of minority difference, where you saw, you know, Coca-Cola, you know, Avis Rent-A-Car, universities, the U.S. government getting in on the representation game, but you also saw it in the art world, you know, in art institutions. And that was not something I talked about, you know, in the reorder of things, but this afforded me with them a chance to talk about that.
You had mentioned Canada at one point, so I'll invite you to say more about that.
Yeah, so when I started this project before I was using the motif of the bookshop, and I'll say a bit about why I'm using the motif of the bookshop. I just thought, okay, I want to write a book that is a history of Black queer diaspora formations, and just based on what I knew at the time, the kind of correspondences, the letters between Black queer artists in the U.S. and Black queer artists in the U.K., I thought, oh, okay, well, that's where my mind went. And then let me say something too. I started that project because, you know, as a kind of critique and different telling of the history of neoliberalism, one, because most histories of neoliberalism never talk about Blacks. the role of the aesthetic necessarily in it. Or, somehow Black queer art and activism is thought to be outside of that. And I've always thought that to be curious and wrong. So I wanted to write something that kind of corrects that. But then also, I wanted to, you know, think about the 70s and 80s, which are awful times in many ways, like awful, awful times. But they were also great. In terms of people doing a lot of stuff in the 70s and 80s, you know, even as, you know, at least in the US and UK, Reagan and Thatcher were destroying public housing, you know, were dismantling the welfare state, were defunding, you know, higher education. And yet people, artists and activists were producing like mad. A lot of them who had just discovered that they were HIV positive and still having, you know, discussions in their groups, you know, about, okay, I just discovered I'm HIV positive, and so how do I get this short story done? Because I don't know how much time I have left, right? And so I wanted to present a history of neoliberalism, you know, in all of its devastations, right? In all of its despair, but also a presentation of neoliberalism in neoliberal times in which people were finding reasons to get up in the morning. You know, so how do you make that legible, you know, on the page as a theory, you know, as a history? Canada. So when I presented years ago, this is again before the bookshop motif, at the University of Toronto, several students there said to me, you gotta talk about Black Canadian queers. And I said, okay, so, you know, just tell me what to read. And they were like, our dissertations. I'm like, okay. You know, that presents some issues, but, you know, I'll try to work with that. And so since that time, I have been leaning a lot on Dion Brand's work, NRBC Phillips. The work that Renata Walcott has also done. So that the bookshop metaphor came to me because I still wasn't, even when I was trying to at one level present the sort of philosophical implications of the work, so like with Hume and things, I still wasn't, and also talk about these artists and talk about like the activism and, you know, what was going on economically and politically, you know, in these places, I still wasn't clear, okay, so what's the container for all of this? I'm not sure how to put this in the container of a book, you know. And then I went and saw two exhibits, one especially meaningful 2 years ago in London, and on a now defunct black bookshop called the Bogle the Vulture Bookshop. And they reproduce, the curators reproduce elements of the bookshop in the gallery space. And then I thought, this is it. You know, because it also reminded me of the first black bookshop that I went to. And I thought, okay, I will make up a black queer bookshop in which there are all these artifacts and histories, people living and dead in it, you know? And that will be the container for everything. Okay.
If we could take some of the theorizing of the Beatz photos, and how we can think through sort of production of photos today, and thinking especially, you know, looking at the way as much, not so much photos produced for art, but photos that are produced for survival, like how we use them online and creating them with online persona. I guess I'm specifically thinking of young people, especially queer,
yes,
trans, and color, and the ability to be able to take photos of oneself.
Yeah.
Put them online and create a narrative back. You know, especially how you might be transitioning or you might be homeless, like how the creation of a photo,
yes,
allows for a reinterpretation of what might be going on in your life.
Oh, good. Yeah, no, great question. Two things. One, you know, there's a kind of self-archiving that's just part of everyday practice for young people. I mean, you archive with your phone, you know, now, through the photos that you take or the text that you send. I mean, that's the generation of a library, really. But we don't talk about it in those terms, but that's exactly what's going on. And there's a kind of, not just kind of, there is a self-archiving project here, but also with the other artists from the 70s and the 80s, you know, who were literally not sure they want to be around the week after that, you know. So the relationship between, you know, between archival fever and death is very much present with these folks, right? You know, it was explicit. It's implicit when young people do it, because like we don't ever think they're gonna die. But you know, there is something ontological about archiving and its proximity and the proximity of death, you know, to that practice. And so that's one. Two, the other thing that I'm, you know, trying to do is, you know, kind of reactivate an earlier moment in, you know, what we now think of as Black History or Black Studies, and that's the moment of the late 19th and early 20th century where, you know, everyday people, lay historians, lay academics, it's one wonderful story of a janitor who, you know, was just scrapbooking, you know, in the early 1900s, a Black janitor, just scrapbooking everything he could find about Black people. And other people who were doing the same thing, right, producing these scrapbooks. Well, those scrapbooks became the basis of the Black History and Black Studies archives, you know, like at Fisk University, Howard University's Morton Spingarn, you know, the great, the Schomburg collection, you know, in New York, the Schomburg Library, all began, you know, because of these sort of informal collecting practices, you know, by these folks who wanted to, you know, in some senses rebut, you know, stereotypical images, in other instances to record those images, right? You know, you think about, there's this book that Toni Morrison did when she was an editor at Random House called The Black Book. And it's just it's a scrapbook, it's a collection of everything about Black people, you know, that she and the other curators could find. And it's in that scrapbook that she finds the story of Margaret Gardner, which then becomes the basis of her Pulitzer Prize winning novel, Beloved, you know. And I had always thought that that was a singular, you know, sort of exceptional effort on the part of Morrison, only later to find out, no, this is actually what founded Black Studies, you know, the sort of curiosity of the laity. You know, again, the scrapbooking exercise as a way to preserve the dignity, but also to preserve the memory of death. I mean, so there's all this stuff in there about, like, you know, pictures and accounts of lynchings.
Okay, that's all the time we have now. Let's get another